Hello, welcome. My name is Paul Saxman, and welcome to the premiere episode of The Mobile Experience. In this series, we'll be covering UI guidelines and design principles for building location-based applications with maps. In this episode in particular, we'll be covering how to implement an interface for browsing a list of places using a scrollable view interface, or view pager in Android. In iOS, that the equivalent would be a UI scroll view using pagination or paging. To demo actually this technique, we're going to actually build an application over a series of episodes. We're calling this application the Walker or Walkway app. The principle is designed on or based on what we presented in Google I/O. That was the Walker app, and in the show called Making Location Meaningful with the Google Maps APIs. This application covers a number of use cases. Primary use case is actually displaying a view or showing a route for exploring a location. The user can view a list of places along this route. They can choose which places they want to maybe stop by or maybe not stop by. They can also tweak the types of places they want to see. So if they want to stop by cafes or museums, they can put that in there. Maybe they don't want to stop by these places, they'd rather stop by the bar. So basically, they establish a route and also establish a series of places that they want to stop by. Another thing that we might add to this application in the future is maybe like a social aspect. We could do something like Waze for walking. It might be kind of fun, but that would definitely be in a much further future episode. So with that, why don't we jump into a quick demo of the application the way it is right now. You can see here the application is kind of takes some inspiration from the Google Maps mobile application, and that's actually on purpose. They did put a lot of effort into building a nice user interface that is single-handed exploration. You can see on the bottom here, we have a view pager. The view pager is this white box in the bottom. Right now, it says the Ferry Building. And if you see, if I take this view pager and I slide across, you see a new place in the map, and you also see a new place in the view pager. So right now, it's saying Exploratorium. So this view pager, the point of this is actually it allows the user to navigate through a list of places very rapidly just using their thumb. Like I said, this is a single-handed interface, which is very nice for, if you're actually carrying a bag, you're walking along, carrying your coffee or other beverage, and you just want to quickly browse through this list of places on the map. Another thing you'll notice about this interface as well is that we have a nice big map. The purpose of the big map is to allow the user really easy navigation with their thumb on the map as well. Smaller maps, actually, a little harder to get kind of more accurate positioning. And also, the large map lets us zoom out to a high enough level so that we can see all of the places at one time. So this is just a pre-canned list of places that I put in the application, but future episodes will maybe integrate with the Places API to do a dynamic list and allow the user, like I said, to add and remove their own places. Another thing that you'll notice is when I'm actually sliding the view pager is that there's only one marker highlighted on the map at a time. So the highlighted marker corresponds to what's displayed in the view pager. And the interesting thing about this eliminates the need for using info windows. So the bad thing about info windows is if the map is actually scrolled off to the side and the marker is no longer displayed, you no longer see the last thing that you selected. But using the view pager, you actually still see the place in the bottom of the screen. I can get back to the map. So as you see, as I'm scrolling through the list of places in the view pager, one marker is highlighted any one time. The other thing that I did here is these dot markers, or measle markers, if you may. These are also touchable or clickable. If I click on one of these, it actually takes focus, and the view pager updates its position. So the nice thing about this is the user can actually navigate entirely on the map. They don't actually have to use the view pager if they don't want to. So they can explore the area spatially using the map instead of exploring the places using the view pager. And another thing that's implemented here is if the user actually clicks on the highlighted marker, you see you get this nice zoom-in effect. This is kind of the detail mode. You get the same effect if you actually touch or just click the view pager for the highlighted place. It zooms in and actually shows detailed view. A future episode, what we can do is maybe add more detailed information about the place. For example, in the Google Maps mobile application, what that does is when you click on the place, it pulls up a drawer where you can actually see more information. We're not going to try to implement everything that the Google Maps mobile application does, but where it makes sense in this application, we might integrate those designs. So what I did with the back button is it has two states now. One, if we're zoomed in a detailed mode, you see here if I click the back button, it's going to zoom back out to the full map mode. So essentially, the first mode is resetting the map. The second mode is actually going to reset the view pager, so the user can actually get back to the original location in the list. Because remember, this is actually a walking path, so we're going from the ferry building to the very last place, which is Yerba Buena Gardens. So at some point, the user may want to actually get back to the very first place. And using the back button is a very nice way to do that. If I were building this application in iOS, which doesn't have a back button, you'd probably want to put some kind of UI control, maybe in the title bar or in the menu bar, or an overlay over the map that allows a user to actually reset their map state. So with that, I'm going to start kind of jump into a little bit of code to kind of show you how this is implemented in Android. This part will get a little bit boring for UIOS developers, but we'll potentially actually implement the same interface in iOS in a future episode and kind of share that code with you as well. So if we take a look at the code now for this application in Android, you can see here that this is the layout file for the main interface. So we only have one interface here. If you remember the application, you know I've removed everything, all the superfluous UI controls like the action bar for the time being. So all we have is the map and the view pager at the bottom. You see this frame layout. This just allows me to actually do overlays on top of the map. There's just a very subtle shadow effect over the view pager. And the bottom here is where you actually see the view pager itself. It's very simple to implement. It's part of the support library, which means that it's supported across a number of different Android releases. And essentially, all you need is a position for it and the layout width and height. I've actually specified the height. I fixed the height to 85 dpi, which was a nice height for thumb swiping. When you think back to the interface on the phone, it was a little bit sparse. I mean, there was just a little bit of text in there. Eventually, we can add more information to that view pager, similar to how we would potentially use an info window. So if we go back actually to the code itself, instantiating the view pager, I'm just going to pull it out of the layout, give it a pager adapter, and I'll discuss the pager adapter in a little bit. The pager adapter is actually how you get the data and the views instantiated for the view pager. And here I've implemented an on-page change listener. So this is actually how I'm capturing these events as the user swiping from left to right. And I'm using this event to actually open up or change the focused marker. So I'm taking the previously focused marker, shrinking it down to a dot marker, and the inverse, taking the new highlighted marker and blowing it up. Let's take a look at the page adapter now, or pager adapter. So there's several different versions of this. There's the pager adapter, which is the base class, and then there's two concrete implementations of this. There's the fragment pager adapter and the fragment state pager adapter. The latter two actually require you to instantiate fragments. These are actually for the pages in the view pager. I chose to use just a pager adapter to instantiate views, not fragments, just because it's a lot simpler for this use case. Future episodes, though, I'd actually probably want to think about actually migrating to the fragment state adapter and actually making these pages actually first-class citizens or reusable components. Right now, they're just kind of baked into the application. This is a very simple and quick and easy way to get up and running with these pages. As you can see in the application right now, it's just essentially the name of the place. Here I'm actually attaching a on-click listener to the view. That's how I'm actually allowing the user to actually zoom in to get the detailed view. So as the click event on the view pager allows me, or a click event on the view in the view pager allows us to zoom in to that particular place on the map. So coordinating between the map and the view pager. The way I'm actually doing all this coordination in this code between the view pager and the map is using indices, because the view pager, when you get events on the view pager, it's by position, what page you're on in the view pager. I use that position to go back to my collection of places or markers to actually update them in the map. So, and that's this code following below. The next thing that we'll probably want to look at is the marker itself. So the markers are fairly simple. All I did here, though, is I added a on-click listener or on-marker click to the map. That allows me to do two things. If the user clicked the currently highlighted marker, You get the zoom in feature, the detailed view. If it's not the currently selected one, then we go through that process of highlighting it and updating it. So essentially just calling the view pager, telling the view pager to update its item. Then the view pager gets that event and does its work to actually change which marker is highlighted. So that's pretty much it for the code. There's a few things that I'll probably want to add to this. Let's take a look at the application one more time. So a few things that I ran kind of a little mini usability study. I took this application, gave it to a few of my friends. I said, you know, play around with it, tell me what you think. And they gave me some really good feedback. I mean, a few people isn't, you know, an extensive study, but it's always good when you have somebody else that's not besides yourself or somebody that you aren't working really closely with on an application to take a look and kind of tell you what they think. So one thing, bit of feedback that I got is it's not always obvious that the view pager is an interactive component on this interface. When you first start the application, you know, you just see, you know, whatever the default was here, this ferry building. It's not necessarily apparent that you can actually swipe left and right on the view pager. So one trick that we might think about implementing here to actually make it apparent to the user that it is interactable or interactive is on startup, you can actually give it a little bit of a wiggle. So have the view pager maybe move left and right or actually iterate through a few items to actually show the user how it works. You could do this only the first couple of times on startup and then not do it anymore. Another thing that you could do, and actually I've seen this implementation, that implementation on another application, it was the OpenTable application that has a similar interface. They do that on startup. Another thing that you could do is put in angle brackets on the right-hand side, right or left-hand side of the view pager. That generally indicates that, you know, there's more information, give the user some kind of clue that they can actually kind of find more information to the left or right. So it'd be a nice interface thing to add to this application. Pager looping. So another bit of feedback that I got is that when you get to the beginning or end of this list of places, it can be a little bit of frustrating when you can't continue on. You might want to actually, instead of stopping at the last page or the last marker, actually just flip over and start at the beginning again. I don't know if that's necessarily easy to implement with the view pager. I think it might be more easy to if you had just a scrollable view of some sort. One thing we could do is potentially just when the user gets to the end, just automatically take it back to the beginning. You could add a number of kind of repeated places to the repeated views to the view pager. So as the user keeps scrolling on, you're getting new views, but you're essentially these are views of the same data. A number of different things we could do, but yeah, definitely it seems like a little bit of a frustrating thing to get to the end of this list and not be able to kind of start over. And one last thing, so as you can see, what's happening here is as I'm scrolling through this list of places in the view pager, I'm actually recentering the map. So actually the highlighted marker is in the center of the map, which is a very nice design because you actually always have, you know, what's important in the middle. However, we wouldn't always have to reposition the map if the highlighted marker, or the newly highlighted marker, is already near the center. We could just highlight that marker as the user scrolls through. And that allows if the user has repositioned the map, if they're looking at something that's kind of a neighborhood that's more relevant or an area of the map that's relevant to them, and they scroll to a new marker that's on that place, on the map already, we're not actually recentering the map for them. I actually played around with that a little bit. It wasn't too easy to do off the top of my head, just because it was what you have to do is you can tell which markers are on the current the map, but you can't tell how much padding is around those markers. So, for example, if one of these markers was off to the edge, I could tell if it was on the map, but I can't tell if I inflate the marker or make the marker bigger if the marker is visible on the map. So there's a few things that I might try to play around with on that, but. For a future episode, but this is how we're going to keep it for the time being. We don't think Zoom is necessarily a bad thing, but we always want to make this a little bit better. There's a few things that I was going to, few things that are kind of interesting to kind of mention about this interface as well, that I think is that we'll also work on or potentially talk about in a future episode. You can see that I took the action bar out. That's only just because I don't have any other in-app navigation presently in this application. If I did want to have other activities, I definitely want to have an action bar. Otherwise, you know, I'd also consider putting in a navigation bar in a future episode. For example, if I want to browse, or have other commands that you could do, let's say, you know, if you want to add or remove places from the list of places on the map or redo your search, a navigation bar would be nice. And the way to get to the navigation bar would be via the action bar or actually a drawer handle. But, you know, we'll play around with that in future episodes. The other thing that's kind of interesting with this interface, you can actually see in the code, is these dot markers are actually shape drawables. So they're simple enough as vector graphics or kind of vector shapes that I can define them as a XML shape drawable. They're just a circle with a gradient inside. That allows me to actually scale them to any size that I want dynamically if I want to. And also, if I do want to like change the color or the style of these markers, I don't have to go back to my drawing tool and you know regenerate raster images for that. I can just go in and actually tweak the color settings. I thought about actually doing it even more dynamically. So for example, with the highlighted marker, I mean, these are the default markers that come with the Maps SDK. You specify the hue that you want to use. You could take that hue and actually apply it to the marker gradient so that you use the hue of the main marker to define the color of the dot markers, but too much work. So having the shape drawable, though, was actually a nice thing to do. Thanks for joining me. I hope you found this episode helpful. The code that I demoed today is actually all available on GitHub. The link is below. We're going to continue to build this application out in future episodes. So if you have any feedback, you can provide it either on GitHub, in the GitHub repository, or on our Google Plus page. We'd be happy to get all your feedback and potentially implement those ideas in future shows. So thanks again.